Fortunately, because it's something that all of us do and all of us are aware of, even from when we were young and our parents would say, go and sit in the car, I will soon be there, or I need to do this, I need to do that. It seems to me that we really haven't given as much thought and credence to the essence of ministries in the church. So what I'm trying to do this morning, or this afternoon, is to try and open it up and share some insights with you. And hopefully, as chairs and co-chairs, you will be able to pass this on as you minister to members of your ministry. Please be free to ask questions, and as much as I can, I will answer them. So the first thing is, what is ministry? What is ministry? It's an act of serving. Act of serving. That act of serving, however, has a kind of things attached to it. The first is that it's an act of serving on behalf of God. That I think we forget sometimes. When you have someone who has been the chair of a particular ministry and they hold on to that, they don't want anybody else. Well, you have to ask yourself the question. Is it your ministry or is it God's ministry? So we are only, as chairs and co-chairs, we are instruments that God uses to serve others. And when you look professionally, that's what happens. Any minister or any secretary is serving people in that department on behalf of the president. So, as chairs and co-chairs, our role is to serve God through the members of the ministry, our members. And in serving them, and I'm sure you all remember, our Lord Jesus Christ says, I've come to serve. To serve. And when we serve, it's not as easy as it may look. Because service means being willing to take ourselves, that pride in us, to put it aside and serve others for the good of all. I know that as human beings, yes, there are times when I want to have my way. But then I quickly ask myself the question, to whose? For the good of whom? So I want to suggest to us this morning that when we take on the spirit of serving, it involves a level of humility. It doesn't matter whether we have PhD or any kind of doctorate or any kind of master's. The church is different. We're all equal in the church. Some people have asked me in all the places I've done, performed ministry. I said, Father God, why is it that you let us do everything? If there's something to be done, you say, you deal with it. Find a solution to it. Rather than some that will come and say, this is how we're going to do it. And start laying down the foundation and controlling everything. And I said, no, I'm not that. My role is to come and serve you and open the doors of your heart to be able to see what God wants from you. So, in a way, I remove myself, or let me say it clearly, I remove the ego that comes with being the rector or the bishop or whatever it is. Remove that ego and open the door for us to feel the presence of Christ with us. So, as a leader, that's what is expected when you're a chair or co-chair. To serve the people in your ministries, to help them, to open the door for them to be closer to God and closer to one another. And what comes with that is, we cannot change anybody. I know that there are those of us who still feel that we can change someone. No. We cannot even change our spouses. The good way to see change in anyone, from my perspective and my experience, is to be caring and loving, to serve them, and in serving them, open the door of their heart for the Holy Spirit to change them. They will change when they have that feeling to change. But if you feel that you have to change them, no, people don't change unless they're ready or want to change. Also, please remember that as chair and co-chair, as priest in charge, we do not have all the answers. A good chair, a good leader, is the one that knows that and the one that is open to suggestions. Even if you don't like it in the beginning, be open to it. Rather than cast it aside. Because, you know, it may be the best suggestion you need to get your ministry vibrant. But because you don't like the person, or you think the person is not one of those running after you to carry your bags for you, you don't want to listen to them. We need to be cautious about that. Because everybody has been given a level of wisdom, a level of knowledge. So ours is not to cast those ideas out. Ours is to welcome the idea, discuss the idea, reflect on the idea. And if it ends up not working, yeah, it will be apparent to everybody. Which leads me to the next point. A good leader has to be transparent. No secrets. Transparency makes people respect you on their own long run. Does that mean that I cannot have a private discussion with with them, yes, I can. But if a situation arises that that discussion has to come out, then I must be with him to share it in a way that is helpful, healthy to all. We have to be good listeners. Good listeners. And in listening, there are many ways in which we listen. The familiar way is when someone is talking before they get to the third or fourth syllable, we already respond. And we think we are listening. You're not listening. The best way to listen, from my experience, is let the person finish whatever they are saying. It gives you more time, if you are truly listening, it gives you more time to reflect on what they are talking about. I always make this joke with people that one of the ways in which, when I grew up, started up thinking about how to listen, as I used to smoke a pipe. And when someone is talking to me, someone that says, this is very important, and I would like my pipe. And if you have smoked a pipe before, there are some steps in reaching, making that pipe light up. First step is you have to clean it. Then you have to stuff it with the tobacco. Then you have to light it. All the time I'm listening. So the person will not only see that I'm paying attention, but they don't know that I'm really reflecting on what they're saying. Act of listening is very important. As the role of a chair, a co-chair. The other thing is, please remember that as chair and co-chair, you are in a fishbowl. Everybody else is watching you. How you speak, how you read, how you care. You may not see yourself in that fish, but people are looking at you. People are seeing you. And so one has to be cautious. Prepare, always prepare before your meetings. Start your meetings with prayer. I don't care what ministry it is. Start with prayer. Why? Because you are serving on behalf of God. So you need to go to that God and ask for that God's wisdom and leadership. I've attended so many ministry meetings. And I'm always surprised when a chair opens the meeting and starts talking about, this is what we're going to do. Without any attention or permission or whatever it is, for others to say something about the plans. If you are doing ministry in the church, as far as I'm concerned, nothing is cast in stone. So you may write all the things you want to do today, but when your meeting is tomorrow, be open to the fact that some may have thought about all that you suggested, and they want a change, they want a discussion. I use this vestry meaning. We all know what it's called, vibes. V-I-B-E-S. I want to challenge you. We need to give good vibes in the way we deal with others. You know, one of my psychological lecturers once said to us, class, he says, you know, when you are meeting with people, please remember that how you posture yourself, how you represent yourself, means a lot to those who are listening to you. He says, if you come out like the dragon shooter, all with force, then they start to guard themselves. They are not willing to be open. And you want people in your ministry to be open, open-minded, to be willing to contribute. He says, but if you come out with a posture that this is our ministry, then people will feel inclined to contribute, because we see that it is ours, not just the chair and the co-chair. Vibes. A good vibe is also inviting. It invites you. It makes you feel comfortable, makes you feel that all is well, you are needed. And this next point, for me, is key. Yes, there are many ways for evangelism, that word. And churches always cry out, oh, we need to go and evangelize. We need to go into our community. We need to do this. We need to do that. We need to have an open service. We need to have all kinds of things we need to do. But I want to say to you this afternoon that one of the best ways, one of the best means of inviting people into your church is true, vibrant ministries. You see, if the ministry you are in charge of, the ministry you are serving, if it's vibrant, if it's something that is welcoming and is and people are excited about it, they're going to share it. They're going to talk about it. And it's going to open every member of your ministry, open them up to be willing to receive people. You see, people think evangelism is all about just going out there and saying, oh, I am from St. Teresa's. We'd like you to come and join us. No. Evangelism comes through our sharing in our daily life. Every member here. Every member of your ministry. Because when new people come in through the door, through those glass doors, if our ministries are vibrant, it doesn't mean it's the usher that has to go and meet them. Everyone will be happy to welcome them. the vibes comes out also again. How we welcome, how we feel, how we make them feel welcome and comfortable. So good ministry, vibrant ministry is important. Then the other thing that I have introduced to the basis of serving is that there has to be time limit. What do I mean by that? We have the tendency to feel that if I'm a chair of a committee, I'm chair of that committee for life. It doesn't work like that. Just look at how the church is structured. Yes, many years ago, a priest can be in charge of a church for the time they were ordained and the time they retire and die. That's why we are not good. When there is time limit, a few things that says, one, you know that yes, you have served well. You need to give the opportunity to someone else to use their skills and their wisdom. Because it's not only you, it's not only me that have the skill and the wisdom. Secondly, it gives the people who are there in your ministry an opportunity to serve. An opportunity to use their own God-given gifts and wisdom and talents. So they will be willing to be more cooperative. They are willing to be able to offer themselves to serve because they know, well, after 3 years, your time is up and somebody needs to step up. What we do most often is that we do it until people start grumbling, and then we say, okay, who's going to take on and be the chair of this ministry? Well, nobody wants to take up something that is wrecked. No. But somebody will be more interested in moving up into a position that is vibrant. That they see that, you know, they are involved with. So I always encourage the same system, the same structure. Every vestry is 3 years. Council is 3 years. So why don't we have 3 years as chair and co-chair? And being a good leader, if you start to prepare, the closer you are to the 3 years, if you start to prepare your co-chair or someone else to take over from you, it's another form of encouragement. It's another form of welcome. It's another form of saying to people, we are all in this together. You see, the church that continues to show people that we are all in this together is the church that grows. Not the church that this is my seat and this is where I will sit as long as I'm in this church. They don't grow. Their children won't even come back to that church. Another word that sometimes in our world today, as I said in my sermon this morning, is a word that somehow we feel that we must have. That's power. Well, my friends in Christ, if we are called to serve God in the ministries, then from my perspective, the one that has the power is God, not me. And that's how I have modeled my ministry up to now. And I don't intend to change. It's has served me well. Some people say, oh, Father God, you're lazy. You're not doing anything. You want everybody to do things, but and I keep saying to them, is it my church? It's not my church. It's God's church put in your life as members of this church. Who am I then? I'm asked to come in and serve you in ways that will open you up to be close to God and I'm out of here. So, power? Yes, power is good when it is used constructively. When it's used with God's wisdom. But when power becomes an instrument of control, an instrument of segregating people, that doesn't help. In actual fact, it breaks up a church. Haven't done a lot with conflicts in the church. When I go to a church that has, I'm always looking at who are the ones controlling this church? Who are the ones holding the power? And if I find them, I'll do my best to work with them to say, yes, it's good to have power, but you have to spread that power. So everybody feels that they are part of it. A good ministry, a good vibrant ministry, does not create cliques. And you all know what I mean by cliques. You do? Or you want me to explain more? Cliques are those little groups of people who always have their own agenda. If you have a vibrant ministry, there's no place for them. You know, that's the most interesting part. Because the only time cliques work is when they feel people are divided. But when you have a vibrant ministry where everybody is involved, where there is transparency, where there is a good vibe that encourages people, that makes people understand they are part of this, we are all together in this, there will be no click. Because nobody's going to listen. They're going to say, what are you talking about? Oh, Cindy is not that kind of person. Jess is not that kind of person. So what are you talking about? We're all in this together. See? Takes the power away from kings and opens the whole congregation into fellowship. So, my friends, one thing I've learned is that when you speak too long, particularly after the lunch, the people sleep. And I don't want you to fall asleep yet. So, I'm open to questions. We Because my challenge is that as we move on, I will try and pray that this pandemic moves away. I would love to meet with each ministry when you have the meetings. Not to take over, no. Just to watch and see how I can help you as a chair or co-chair in managing or serving your ministry. And I know I'm not that naive to know that there are some ministries that might find it more difficult to do all that I've been talking about. But if we take our leadership from God, there is always a way. There will always be a way. Okay. Questions, comments? Yes. For example, when we have funerals, sometimes you, in a lot of churches, sometimes you don't get people who volunteer to help. But if you have a vibrant ministry of hospitality, or there's another one, pastoral, all those ministries, they will be the ones coming forward and offering themselves to serve. Because most times the funerals are members of the parish. So they will know they need to support the family of the deceased. So they won't have to wait for either the senior warden knocking on the door and say, who will give them food on Monday? He or she doesn't have to do that. A vibrant community will have scheduled within their ministry and say, we, from us, who will do A, B, C, D? In other words, putting another word, a vibrant ministry is the one that serves not just themselves, but serves the church. And does everything contributes to the well-running, well-being of the church. I like your mission statement. And when I was asked if I wanted the business card, I said, it has to be on the card. So to be the feet and the hands and the eyes of God, it has to be apparent. And the best way is through your ministries. Ministry of flowers, for example. Pam doesn't have to be asking who will do this, who will do that. Or even people can go to Pam and say, we hear we have this ministry. I know of Mr. Aledani. That might be, that his spirit might be lifted if we give him flowers. That's a good way of offering ourselves. Never look at the church as just one person. It's all inclusive. And the moment we can do that, my friends, you'll be surprised how you will get rid of any conflict. Yes, there's going to be disagreements. But disagreements mustn't lead to conflict. Disagreements are things that you talk about and you in the first instance you will not laugh about it, but later on you go back to that same person, tap them on the shoulder and say, hey, John, I know that the way you think about this yesterday and I thought about this, seems a bit different. But wait a minute, can we talk about this? Comes from the spirit of all being in it together. Any other questions? Yes.
My mind was like this, that if you go to a meeting and you find that the chair and the co-chair are not listening or listening to the guidance, because you've got a guide that you're going to power for,
first couple of steps. One is to have a one-to-one with such a person, with such a chain. Not a hostile discussion, but one that comes from the level of serving. And then see where that goes. Now, don't do that on Sunday morning and then Wednesday decide that the person is not listening. Remember, we cannot change people. So all we can do is to share with them the truth about how we perceive them and how it may be affecting the ministry. That's one. The second one is, I have always believed that if you attack someone, you're going to get an attack back. But if you approach someone from the perspective of being friendly, then you might get a better response. Part of our problem in the world today is that, you know, we say, oh, somebody does this, we have to attack. Not forgetting the fact that it's a roller skate, it's a roller ball. The more you attack back, the more they attack you, and the more you attack back, it never ends well. But if we are in that spirit of discussion, spirit of reminding the chair that we are here to serve God through this ministry, let's think about it, let's talk about it. You might get a change. But I, personally, I know that some people will say, well, suppose the person doesn't change and continues to do, well, it's a time limit. That's part of the time limit. Their time will soon come up. And they will leave. That's better than attacking them. Because when you attack them, you are splitting your ministry. Because there will be those who love them, think what they are doing is right, and those who don't. But when their 3 year comes up, they have to leave anyway. Any other thing? Well, let me say thank you. Thank you for listening to my gab. I pray that we will always remember that we are called by God to serve in the respective ministries that we are serving. And not to never forget that God who has called you into your role will never desert you. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to serve and love the Lord with all your and others. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Invite me to your ministry meetings. And if you don't invite me, I will be suspicious.